following presentation is from St. Paul's United Methodist Church in Oakland, Maryland.
Good morning. Welcome to St. Paul's United Methodist Church on this beautiful Sunday morning. It is the fifth Sunday in Lent. Hey, it's more beautiful than it was last Sunday, except for me. I was in kind of sunny California, right, Pat? And Pat was here. So thank you, Pat and Denise, for your help last week. Appreciate you helping fill in. Thank you, Betty, for being the liturgist last Sunday. And thanks for all those that helped. Bob was here, too. So thank you for your help last Sunday. We appreciate that. And it's good to be back with you this morning. And welcome to St. Paul's United Methodist Church, where we are a mission-oriented family on a journey of following Jesus in the Wesleyan tradition. We're so glad that you're with us this morning, those of you here in the sanctuary, those that are joining us via Facebook. We always love if you say hello to us. I've seen some of you saying hello already today, but let us know where you're watching from, and we love to hear from you. We're also thankful for a radio broadcast on WMSG 1050 AM and WKTZ 95.9 on the FM side. And today, our radio broadcast is in loving memory of Eloise Udovich by Delton and Margaret Fout. And Eloise, of course, was Margaret's mother. So we appreciate Delton and Margaret and their support of the radio broadcast. And today, we remember Eloise Udovich. This time, let us enter into worship with our prelude. Thank you, Bob. Let's join together in our call to worship today. From all walks of life, Christ desires to bring us into the fold of God's love. Seeking after us, God meets us where we are. Come, let us worship the God who came to seek and save the lost. Come, let us worship the God who came to seek and save each of us. We welcome God into our hearts and our homes. We rejoice in the God who seeks and saves. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you that in Jesus Christ you came to seek and save the lost. Open our hearts today to receive the invitation of Jesus to come and be present in our lives. As we worship you, release us from our smallness and create an atmosphere of confession and healing love in our hearts. Show us a vision of your justice and empower us with your Holy Spirit so that we do not lose hope. We pray in the name of Jesus, the one who came to save us and set us free. Amen. Let's join together in two hymns of worship, and please stand if you're able. Pass me not, O gentle Savior, and oh, how he loves you and me. Let's sing together. time, we invite the children to come forward for our Jesus Loves Me moment.
Hey guys, how are you today?
That's good. Good to hear. So happy Sunday to you. So, how tall are you guys?
I'm about 5 feet. I think.
You're about 5 feet. Really?
I'm tall.
Are you? Yeah, you're tall. How tall are you? Do you know? You don't know? You have to stand up. Let me see how tall you are, buddy. Are you gonna, here, step on this. There you go. Whoa. Oh, 57 inches. How tall is that? Almost 5 feet. Thank you. Pat, how tall are you?
More than 5 feet.
Betty, how tall are you?
4'9" and a half.
4'9" and a half. That half is very, very important, isn't it? How tall are you? Do you know?
No.
Do you want to see? How tall do you think you are? Here you go. Woo! But stand up straight. Oh, 45 inches. That's a good height, isn't it? That would be like, what, 3 feet? 3 feet something. 9 inches. You do measurements, don't you? How tall are you, Lila? You don't know? Do you care? You want to know how tall you are? Okay. Here you go. Woo! Stand up tall. Oh, look at that. You are 53 inches. You just got a little bit. You're really getting close to those guys, aren't you? You're just a year younger, so you'll be there soon. But why are we talking about heights today? Because we're talking about a story in the Bible. Do you know any story about short people in the Bible? No? You do? Who? He was a tax collector. That's good. What else did he do? You know anything else? He climbed up a tree. Yeah, that's that. There's a song about that, right? You know, so his name's Zacchaeus, and it goes like this. Zacchaeus was a wee little man. A wee little man was he. He climbed up in the sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. And as the Savior passed that way, he looked up in the tree and he said, Zacchaeus, you come down, for I'm going to your house today. I'm going to your house today. You ever heard that song? No? You have? Oh, you have. Yes, that's good. So that's our story. So here's the thing about Zacchaeus. He heard about this parade, and there was this parade, and Jesus was marching in the parade. And he wanted to get there and get a really good seat for that parade. But you know what? Because he was short, he couldn't see. There were so many people there and the crowd of people. And he was behind there. What do you do when you can't see, Betty?
I climb up on a stool.
You climb up on a stool. That's a great answer. So there. Hey, Eden, will you climb up there? So he couldn't see. And... so, can you see more from there? Is that a better vantage point? No. What do you think?
I think it's perfect.
It's perfect? Mm-hmm. That's good. You can see Bud in the back. Can you see that far? Could you see him before?
Yeah.
So it doesn't really give you a better vantage point here. But if there were a bunch of people in front of you, would that help you to see better? Yeah, that's right. So this is what Zacchaeus did. He had to get to a higher vantage point. So he did what he did, climb up in a tree. You ever climb up in a tree? No? That's not safe to climb up in trees, is it? You climb up in lots of trees. That's good. No, you're not tree climbers. You stay on the ground. So here's the thing. If you're up there, he got to see Jesus, and Jesus called him down and said, hey, Zacchaeus, I'm going to go to your house today. And Zacchaeus was demonstrated then that Jesus loves Zacchaeus. So here's the lesson. Doesn't matter how tall we are, or how high we stand, or how short we are, Jesus still loves us. Isn't that good news? That's good news, isn't it? So it doesn't matter how big or little we are, Jesus loves us, and he wants us to be part of his family. And that's what he did for Zacchaeus, and that's what he does for each one of us. We are part of his family. We're never too young. We're never too old. We're never too short. We're never too tall. Pat says amen. We're never too anything for God to love us, because God loves us, and that's why he sent Jesus. That's good news. Let's pray today. Lord, we thank you today. We thank you for this good news. The good news, Lord, that you love us, no matter how small, no matter how big, no matter how short, no matter how tall. We thank you, God, that you are the God who comes to seek and save us, and that you sent your son, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Here's a sheet for you today. This says, it's a picture of a tree, and it says, Jesus sees you and loves you, so you can color that, and then put your name up there in the tree. Because you can remember that Jesus sees you and loves you. Thank you, guys. This is up here if you need it, Betty. I'm going to fall over there. Okay, our attempt to praise today. Jesus Messiah, and I'm forever grateful. Let's stand and sing together.
Sin who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. He humbled himself and carried the cross. Love so amazing, love so amazing. Jesus Messiah. Jesus Messiah.
Scripture reading today comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 19, verses 1 through 10. The Gospel of Luke, chapter 19. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through it. A man was there named Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was rich. He was trying to see who Jesus was, but on account of the crowd, he could not because he was short in stature. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore tree to see him because he was going to pass that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, "Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for I must stay at your house today." So he hurried down and was happy to welcome him. All who saw it began to grumble and said, "He is going to be the guest of one who is a sinner." Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, "Look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor, and if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much." Then Jesus said to him, "Today, salvation has come to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek out and to save the lost." This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to
God. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you today for your word. We thank you that as we've gathered together in your name, that you are here in our midst. And we pray that as we explore this passage together, that you would speak to our hearts, that you would change our lives, that you would help us to become the disciples, the men and women that you're calling us to be. May it be so in the mighty name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Well, thanks to the children's song, we know this story. We know that Zacchaeus was a wee little man. A wee little man was he. We know that he climbed up in a sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. We know that as the Savior passed that way, he looked up in the tree and he said, "Zacchaeus, you come down, for I'm going to your house today." Everybody knows that much of the story, but not everybody knows, as Paul Harvey would say, the rest of the story. Jesus had entered Jericho. Luke tells us that Zacchaeus is living in that city and that he's a tax collector. In fact, he is the chief tax collector for the whole region, and he's rich. Oh, and one more thing, he's short. How How short was he? Luke doesn't say. But when I think of Zacchaeus, I picture Danny DeVito. Danny DeVito from back in like the Taxi days, right? Zacchaeus, he must have heard about Jesus, because when he hears that Jesus is passing through the city, he tries to see the parade, but the crowd prevents him from being able to see and being able to have a good front row spot. Being a resourceful type, Zacchaeus runs up ahead and he climbs into that tree because he wants a good view of Jesus and a good view of the parade. Jesus' entourage reaches Zacchaeus, and Jesus sees Zacchaeus sitting in the fork of that tree and recognizes him. And immediately he surprises everyone when he says, "Zacchaeus, hurry up. You get down from there, because I'm having dinner with you today. I'm having dinner with you today." Zacchaeus thought he was seeking Jesus, but you know what? It turns out that it's Jesus who was seeking him. And the short little tax collector hurries down out of that tree, and he stands before Jesus. Can you see him there? You know, breathing hard, brushing pieces of bark and leaves off of his clothes, and looking up with a big embarrassed grin at Jesus. But Luke says he was happy. He was happy to welcome Jesus. And I begin to wonder whether Mrs. Zacchaeus was happy to have an uninvited dinner guest. But then the story takes an ugly turn. It says the crowd begins to grumble. Jesus has gone to be the guest of one who is a sinner. And I probably need to say more about that, because my mom was the tax collector for the town of Kitzmiller for years, and I don't think she was a sinner. But in Zacchaeus' time, tax collectors were Jews who collected taxes from their fellow Jews for the Roman Empire. And they made their living by charging an extra amount. And some of them made more than a living. They exacted any amount that they could, and so they became very well-to-do. They were considered traitors who became wealthy by collaborating with the Roman authorities at the expense of their own people. And so when Luke tells us that Zacchaeus was rich, we begin to wonder, has he charged his fellow Jews more than he should have? The crowd may have had good reason to grumble. But it's the next part of the story where you have to pay attention, because everything hinges on how we interpret what happens next. When I think back to most sermons that I've heard on this passage, I think those sermons have emphasized something along the lines of how encountering Jesus can change your life. Encountering Jesus can change your life. It can it? It can. And that's where I was going. That's what this sermon was going to be about. And then I realized two things. First, I realized that encountering Jesus doesn't necessarily change your life. In the chapter before this one, Luke 18, there's this rich young ruler. He comes to Jesus and he encounters Jesus, and he says, "Jesus, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" And Jesus tells him, "Keep the commandments." And that rich young ruler insists that he keeps the commandments, that he's kept him all his life. And Jesus says, "Okay, just do one more thing. Sell your possessions and give the money to the poor." And that's when the rich young ruler walks away sad. Sad because he couldn't bear to part with his stuff. The rich young ruler encountered Jesus and didn't change. As a result, Jesus said that it's awfully hard for rich people to enter the kingdom. The second thing that I realized concerned the verbs in this passage. Now, I'm a grammar nerd, but still, let's track this with me. In the New Revised Standard Version, the version that we read, verse 8 says this: "Zacchaeus stood there and said to the Lord, 'Look, half of my possessions, Lord, I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will pay back four times as much.'" But this week I was reading the story in the King James Version, the old King James Version. And this is how the King James translates this verse: "Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, 'Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore him fourfold.'" Now, you might not have noticed the difference, but there's a big difference between those two versions. One is in the future tense: "I will give half my money to the poor." And the other is in the present tense: "I already give half my money to the poor." And when it comes to interpreting this story, we need to know, was Zacchaeus so moved by his encounter with Jesus that he made up his mind then and there to give up half his money to the poor? Or was Zacchaeus already doing that and couldn't understand why everyone was calling him a sinner? Now, I like the New Revised Standard Version. It's a faithful translation of the Bible's original languages. But the King James Version picks up on something that the New Revised Standard Version and some other translations choose to ignore, and that is this. The verbs are in the present tense. Zacchaeus does not say, I will give half my money to the poor. He says, I do already give my money to the poor. And Zacchaeus doesn't say, if I cheat anyone, I will pay them back four times over. He implies that that's his custom. He says, if I cheat anyone, if I find out I cheated anyone, I pay them back four times over. And if you read it in the original languages, it's as clear can be. But the translators of this passage want so much for it to be a conversion story in which Zacchaeus encounters Jesus and becomes a changed man that they have converted the verbs from the present to the future tense. But here's my question. What if we don't change the verbs to the future tense? What if we read this story just the way that Luke wrote it? In that case, Jesus might have already heard about Zacchaeus' legendary generosity. Oh, he's a tax collector, someone might have said, but he gives a lot of money to the poor, and if he finds out that he's cheated anyone, he always pays them back. Jesus might have said, I got to see that guy. And so when he comes to Jericho, Jesus might have already been looking for him. And even though Zacchaeus was hiding in a tree, peeking out through the branches, Jesus found him. And he said, there you are. Come down out of that tree. I've got to go to your house today. I've got to find out what makes you tick. And Zacchaeus scrambles down out of that tree, happy to do so, happy that Jesus was coming to his house. He might have been a wee little man, but he was the biggest giver in town and the most ethical tax collector in Israel. But again, this is where the story takes an ugly turn, because the crowd starts grumbling. Jesus has gone to be the guest of a sinner. But Zacchaeus draws himself up to full height, and he says, now wait a minute, Lord. I may be a tax collector, but I give half my money to the poor. And if it turns out I've cheated anyone, I pay them back four times over. And then, without a word about sin or repentance, Jesus says, today salvation has come to this house, for he too is a son of Abraham. Luke says that he said it to Zacchaeus, but I believe the second part of that was addressed to the crowd, because they were the ones that said Zacchaeus was a sinner. You notice Jesus never says that Zacchaeus was a sinner. The crowd were the ones who had shoved him outside the circle of their fellowship. Jesus had a very different assessment of Zacchaeus than the crowds did. Jesus says, you say this man's a sinner, but I say he's a son of Abraham. You know, earlier in Luke chapter 3, John the Baptist tells us what it means to be a true child, a true son or daughter of Abraham. He said, the one having two coats must share with anyone who has none. And the one having food must do likewise. And then Luke says, that there in chapter 3, that even tax collectors came to John the Baptist to be baptized. And they asked him, teacher, what should we do? And he said to them, collect no more than the amount arranged for you. And soldiers also asked him, and we, what should we do? And he said to them, exhort and defraud no one, and be content with your wages. Jesus looked past the stereotypes. Jesus looked past the scorn of the crowds to recognize that Zacchaeus, this tax collector, conducts himself as a true child of Abraham. Unlike the crowd, Jesus sees Zacchaeus, really sees him, when so many in the crowd despise and ignore him. What if all the time Zacchaeus was actually a righteous person? What if he made his riches honestly and was discarded by his community anyway? What if Zacchaeus took this tax collecting job and he worked for Rome so that less honest men wouldn't? What if he was trying to spare the poor in whatever way he could? What if the community hated him for working with this oppressive political system, even though he was trying to protect them from it?
What if salvation isn't about Zacchaeus repenting, but about Jesus helping a community realize that they've defamed a righteous man? Well, the takeaway becomes, where we have judged others without knowing them, where have we judged others? Where have we judged others without sitting at table with them, without truly seeing them? See, Jesus sees Zacchaeus as a son of Abraham, not because Zacchaeus has repented of grievous sins, but because he's extremely generous to the poor, and he joyously welcomes Jesus into his home. He shows the same hospitality that Abraham did. And the crowd looks at Zacchaeus. They see only a sinner. Jesus looks at Zacchaeus, and he sees a child of Abraham, one who is generous and hospitable, someone through whom, like Abraham, God could bless the world. And by recognizing that, Jesus changes Zacchaeus' status. Jesus saves him. You know that word save? It means to help, to heal, to make well, to make whole. And I believe that when Jesus put his arms around Zacchaeus, when he told the citizens of Jericho that Zacchaeus too was a son of Abraham, something that had been broken for a long time was made whole. Zacchaeus was restored to his place in the community, and Zacchaeus experiences a healing, a salvation that results in wholeness and restoration to that community. And so maybe this is a conversion story after all. But the ones who are converted are the people in the crowd. Maybe they're able to see Zacchaeus in a different way after this, not as the sinner they thought he was, but as the son of Abraham that Jesus says he is. And maybe on the following Sabbath day, they would have been able to open the door of the synagogue to him in order to welcome him in. You see, appearances can deceive. I know that's true for me. It's probably true for you too. What we think we see is not always reality. We like to sort people out. We like to judge them. We like to put labels on them. Homeless, ex-con, filthy rich, addict, mentally ill, tax collector, sinner. Only to discover that the way Jesus sees them and names them is very different. Professor David Loess notes, Jesus cares about those who are on the edge. Throughout Luke's gospel, Jesus encounters those whom society has declared unfit and wants to ignore, and he sees them, recognizes them, seeks them out, spends time with them, and in all these ways honors and blesses them. The only thing this God cares about is seeing and seeking out the lost and bringing them home again. That's why I came, Jesus says. Jesus says, I came to seek and save the lost. Jesus is looking for all those people who have been pushed out of the circle of God's love so that he can bring them back in again. And so maybe the ones who are lost are not only those people who have never darkened the door of a church, but those who have somehow gotten pushed out and shunned out and shamed out. Are we willing to see them and find them and bring them back? Can you think of anyone like that today? That woman who used to come here every Sunday and drink in every word that was said and sing the hymns at the top of her lungs, but then something happened and she became an outsider. What about the young man who might have grown up in this church, but who's afraid to come here now, afraid that if we knew who he was or really knew what he's done, that we'd ask him to leave? Are these the lost that Jesus is looking for? And if Jesus is out there, if Jesus is seeking them and finding them and bringing them back into the circle of God's love, well, brothers and sisters, why aren't we doing the same? Amen. Lord, we thank you today. We thank you for this story of Zacchaeus. And Lord, we thank you that you are all about seeing us for who we really are. Lord, we confess that so often we're like the crowd. We label people. We think we know what they're about. But Lord, you take the time to really get to know us. You take the time to see our heart. You take the time to seek us out and to restore us into the community. You, Lord, come to seek and to save all of those who are in the margins so that we all might experience your love. Some of us today are like Zacchaeus. Some of us feel outside and alienated, feel like the whole world is judging us. And God, I pray that for those people that are like Zacchaeus, that you would help us today to see that you are the God who is reaching out to us. You're the God who really, truly sees us. You are the God who really, truly loves us. And you have come to seek us and to save us and bring us back into the umbrella of your love. Some of us today, Lord, we confess we're like the crowds. We label and we judge. And Lord, I pray that you would help us to repent of how we have done that and that you would help us to, Lord, see people through the eyes of Jesus. See people as those who are deserving and worthy of your love. People who are deserving and worthy to be part of the community of faith. And that you would help us, God, to reach out to them and to wrap our arms of love around them, because that's what you do. You wrap your arms around us and you embrace us with your love. We thank you for that good news today. In Jesus' holy name we pray. Amen. Our hymn of response today is Spirit Song. You know, in that text when it says Jesus came to seek and save the lost, it's talking about how he came for the lost sheep of Israel. All of us. He's come to fill us today. And as we sing this Spirit Song, just invite the Holy Spirit to come and fill you and allow God to wrap his arms of love around you today. He's here this morning, and if you would like to come and spend a few moments at the altar in prayer, I invite you to come and do that as we sing together, 347 Spirit Song. Share with us any joys or concerns, things that we could rejoice with you about or that we could pray with you about this morning. Yeah, Tracy.
I'd like to share that our family grew by one last week. We received our third grandchild. This time was a grandson. Now we have two grandchildren.
rejoice in that addition to your family and new grandchildren. I believe the son's name is Carter, so we welcome that addition into the family. Yeah, Linda.
The family of Gurney Culp.
Oh, what was the first name?
Gurney Culp.
Gurney Culp.
It's from the accident area.
Okay, pray for that family, the Culp family. Paul.
Those in the military.
Pray for those in the military. Lift them up. Want to pray for the family of George Myers, who passed away. He was serving in the Kitsmiller area, and Carmel White, also from the Kitsmiller area, that passed away. Kendra's aunt Wanda Ward was in an accident last week, and she's still recovering from that, and so wants us to lift up in prayer. Pray for the family of Jane Helmick, and continue to lift up especially John. Her memorial service will be this Saturday, April 9th at 11 here at the church, so I invite you to join us for that. We have some prayer requests here on Facebook. Gloria Thomas and Dorothy Thomas. Pray for Donna Broadwater. Pray for Gavin is an infant that needs our prayers. Wayne Evans. Dreama Lucas, then pray for Chris, Helen Bowser, Kathy Kisner, and Gina Thomas for arthritis, and the family of Milton Prophet, who Milton passed away. Joy from Carol Oak in Florida, that Denise and Jim visited it for 2 weeks, and they're traveling back for two Mountain Lake today, so we will pray for them. The people of Ukraine, we will pray for. Making sure I got it. Is there any others you saw, Sharon?
I don't see any others.
All right. Anything else that you'd like to lift up? Keith?
Stephanie Calvo says, pray if she gets better. She's my friend.
Pray for Stephanie. Okay.
Calvo.
All right. Okay, let us go to the Lord in prayer. Dear Jesus, we are thankful. We are thankful for your love. We are thankful for your grace today. We're thankful that, Jesus, you see us and you love us and you embrace us. Lord, I pray today that you would just wrap your arms of love around us and so many that need your healing touch. We lift up today, Lord, Wanda, and we ask, Lord, that you would surround her for Wayne and Dreama, Lord, for Gloria and Dorothy. We lift up Gavin to you. We pray for your healing power. We lift up Stephanie, God. We pray that you would be with her. Lord, for Gina Thomas and Chris and Wayne and Dreama and all these individuals, Kathy, Lord, and Helen, we pray that you would surround each one that needs your healing power today and that you, the great physician, would come alongside of them and encourage them. Lord, we thank you that you're with us as we travel, and we thank you for time spent with family, and we thank you that Denise and Jim could be with her aunt in Florida, and we pray, Lord, that you'll give them safety as they travel back. And Lord, for all those who are traveling, we pray, Lord, your traveling mercies. Lord, we pray today and thank you, Lord, for baby Carter. We rejoice in this new addition to the Lipscomb family, and we pray your blessings over him and over his whole family. We thank you for this gift of life. Lord, we are thankful as well that you're with us, not just at the beginning of life, but also at the end of life, and you're there as we have to say goodbye to loved ones. And so, Lord, we pray today that you would surround families that are going through grief with your love, for the Kolb family and the Myers family, for the White family, the Coddington family. We lift up the Helmicks, and we ask, God, that you would surround each one of these and many others within our community that are going through times of loss. We thank you that you are with us as we go through these seasons. Lord, today we also lift up the situations in our world.
And Lord, our heart aches for the people of Ukraine and for the situation that continues to go there. And we ask, Lord, that in the midst of this violence, that somehow your love would minister. And we know that it does, Lord, through those who bring aid and through those who are working, Lord, to for rescue efforts and all of the things that they're doing there to try to bring an end to this violence. And we pray, God, that you will give those who are working in the midst of this situation your direction and the guidance of your Holy Spirit. And help them, Lord, to make decisions for justice and righteousness and peace, we pray. Lord, we lift up those who are serving in the military. We ask that you would be with them today and help them as they go about the work that they are called to do. Lord, we lift up all of those who are serving, all of those in our government, all of those, Lord, who are involved in any way in helping, Lord, to protect us and as a nation, Lord, to be what you are calling us to be. And we ask, Lord, that you would lead and guide us as the Church of Jesus Christ to be faithful in our calling, to stand as your people, and, Lord, to be faithful to minister your love and your grace. Lord, show us the ways that we might reach out to those who are lost, and, Lord, that we would be about the business that Jesus was about, of helping people to find their place within the community of God's love, and realizing that those who have been marginalized and alienated, Lord, that they have a place, that they can be made whole within this community of faith and all your love, Lord. We thank you so much for it today. We thank you that it found us and it brought us into your love. And Lord, I pray that you would help us as those who have been recipients of your love to go forth, Lord, to seek and to say by your power, Lord, to help people be restored to the community. We just ask, Lord, that you would help us, empower us for this work. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. So you look at announcements today. Once again, we want to thank Delton and Margaret Fout for underwriting today's radio broadcast in loving memory of Margaret's mother, Eloise Yudovich, and we're thankful for that. Our book club is back on for Sunday night, so that is this evening. We'll be going over Thursday. On Sunday evening, we'll be going over Thursday. So that's tonight at 6 p.m. You can join us for our book study of Fight Like Jesus, How Jesus Waged Peace Throughout Holy Week. So if you'd like to join us tonight at 6. Our Lenten lunch this week, hard to believe this is the last Lenten lunch, but that's at 12 noon this Wednesday. Join us, and we'll have share together in a meal. And then Melissa Paul will be our speaker this week. And so we'll look forward to that time together. Epic Bible Adventures. Our Epic Bible Adventures on Thursday night is a special event because Jeremy the Juggler will be with us. And Jeremy the Juggler is a young guy that shares his faith through juggling. And so we'll look forward to experiencing Jeremy the Juggler this week. So 5:30, we'll gather together for a meal. And then at about 6:30, Jeremy will be sharing. And so we invite you to join us together this week. 5:30 for the meal, 6:30 for the presentation. And there are flyers back there if you'd like to invite people to that event. And we will have a great time together. So join us for that time. That's this Thursday at 5:30. Today, the Easter Basket Project, so we see the Easter baskets up here. We're a project of buying the books for the baskets that will be going to the children at the new Children's Hospital in Morgantown. And so this will be there for Easter. And so next Sunday is the deadline. That's April 10th is the deadline. We thank you for those who've already given, but invite you to give towards this project of purchasing the 200 books that we want to purchase to go into these baskets. And so if you can give towards that, we would greatly appreciate it. Our pennies for mission for the month of April is designated for the Celebration of Mission event. The Celebration of Mission event is a mission event throughout the conference and all the districts that supports all of our conference missions projects. So there's about 10 of them that are listed there. You can read them in the email or you'll see them in the newsletter that'll be coming out this week. And since it's the 25th anniversary of the Celebration of Mission, they're asking that everybody that's able give at least $25 for the 25th anniversary of the Celebration of Mission event. And if you give $25, $5, that's $250 per conference mission project. So if you think of it that way, it's a way to contribute in a small way. And if we all give, it will make a big difference. So you can mark your offering envelope or your check memo with pennies for mission. There will be a baked potato bar on Sunday, the April 24th. It'll start after Sunday school and go until after the second service. So we invite you to come and join us for that. But also, if you can help, I think there might be a list going around with items. If you can help support that with items and your help and your attendance, it would all be greatly appreciated. So we'll look forward to that time together on April 24th as United Methodist Women sponsor the baked potato bar. Jane Helmick's service, I said in our prayer time, but wanted to reiterate that the service for her will be this Saturday, April 9th, right here at the church, and that'll be at 11 a.m., and the family will be here at 10 if you'd like to visit with them prior to that. So 10 o'clock and the service at 11. We're thankful for all of our Sunday school classes. Invite you to join us after this service for Sunday school. We have the preschool upstairs and the elementary school. There's a youth class that meets down in the library. In the Good Shepherd Room, the Pathfinders are meeting and going through The Chosen, so we invite you for that. And the class that meets in my office today, we're starting a new study on angels. So if you're interested in that, today's a good day to join us. So we invite you to join us for Sunday school. Easter lilies. So at the season of Easter, we decorate for the resurrection life that Jesus brings. And one of the symbols of that, of course, is Easter lilies. So we invite you, if you would like to place a lily in memory, honor, or celebration of someone or an event, to fill out the form and the email. There'll also be one in the newsletter that goes out, and you can fill out that form or just call the church office anytime before Wednesday, April 13th. If you want to purchase them through the church, it's $10 each, or if you would like to give, you can just bring it in on Good Friday by 1 o'clock. So we invite you to participate in that and honor those that you would like to honor, celebrate, and rejoice in. Any other announcements that you would like to make today? Thank you once again to those who helped in service last week, and thank you especially to Pat and Denise. We're thankful for you and that you're among us today. And we are blessed with great lay speakers like Betty and Ann and Doug, and we're blessed with great former pastors that come and help us as well. So we are a blessed congregation. We rejoice in all those who help us and lead in our worship. Last week I was at an African-American church on Sunday morning. Some of you might have seen a clip of that on Facebook. So I was ready to dance today, but you guys didn't seem like you were up for it. So. All right. Take a moment to share signs of love and peace with one another. Today it's exciting. Just as Jesus said, Zacchaeus, I'm going to your house today. I got to eat with you today. That's what Jesus says to us. I got to eat with you today. I invite you to come and have table fellowship with me. And so today we come. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and our greatest joy to give you thanks and praise, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. In love, you made us for yourself, and when we had fallen into sin and became subject to evil and death, your love remained steadfast. You bid your faithful people cleanse their hearts and prepare with joy for the Easter feast, that renewed by your word and sacraments and fervent in prayer and works of justice and mercy, we may come to the fullness of grace that you prepared for those who love you. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are holy, O God of majesty, and blessed is Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, whom you sent in the fullness of time to redeem the world. In coming to seek and save the lost, he emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, Being born in our likeness, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even death on a cross. He took upon himself our sin and death and offered himself a perfect sacrifice for the sin of the whole world. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world. Send us forth to seek the lost and to share your saving love until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. Now let us pray with the confidence of the beloved children of God, just as Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen.
This bread which we break is a sharing in the body of Christ. This cup which we bless is a sharing in the blood of Christ. Today, as you come, these are little chalices today, so they're a little different than what we've been using in the past. So, on the one side is the bread, so you can take that one off and you can have the bread. And then on the other side is the juice, so hopefully it won't be as hard. Some people have said these are much easier, and hopefully they might taste better too. All right, we hope so. But we invite you to come today and receive. This is not the table of the church, it's the table of the Lord, and all are invited to come and receive from his hand. You don't have to be a member of this congregation or of any congregation to come. God invites all to come to his table, and all are invited today. And so once you come, for the feast is ready, and Christ is here to meet us. God, we thank you for this table, for this holy mystery in which we encounter you today. We ask, God, that having been nourished at this table, we would now go forth empowered by your Holy Spirit to do your work in the world. We pray this in the mighty name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Thank you so much for your presence here today, and we are so thankful for each and every one of you, and thankful for what you contribute to the body of Christ, and we're thankful that we can gather in his name. We're thankful for those who have joined us today on Facebook, and those who are joining us on the radio. You are a blessing to us as well. This time, we will share in our closing hymn, which is, "This is a Day of New Beginnings." 383. Let's stand to 383. Save the lost. And now we go forth to share that good news with the world. And let's go in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Presentation came from St. Paul's United Methodist Church in Oakland,